Welcome to St. Helen's Anglican Church in Orleans, Ontario, on this third Sunday of Easter, April 26th, 2020. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia. May God's grace and peace be with us and fill our hearts with joy. Please join with Susan and myself as we offer a feast on the Easter word and lead you in prayer. The collect for today. O God, your Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith that we may see him in his redeeming work, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. The first reading is from the book of Acts. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. A moment of prayer for the preacher. Cleopas and his friend, on their way to the village of Emmaus, a journey of about 7 miles. That's 11.2 kilometers in Canada. And it's almost exactly the distance from St. Helens, Orleans, to the village of Navan. However it is measured, it is a good 2-hour walk. And as they walk, they are joined on their journey by Jesus, whom they don't yet recognize, and who says, perhaps not so innocently, "What things?" There is a recounting of recent events, hopes and hopes dashed, visions of angels at an empty tomb. Then Jesus gives his faith witness story about his relationship with God. And as every faith witness story is fascinating, so Cleo says, "Tell us more, stay for supper." Then their eyes are opened, and they recognize Jesus in the breaking of the bread. And Jesus, no longer bound by space and time, vanishes from their sight. They are now compelled to tell that story with someone who might understand, the other disciples. So that same hour, after supper, after dark, they return to Jerusalem on that now familiar 2-hour walk again. And when they arrive, they recount with joy how each of them encountered the risen Christ. Mary recognized Jesus alive and risen in the garden. Thomas recognized Jesus alive and risen in the upper room. Cleopas and his companion recognized Jesus alive and risen at supper in Emmaus. Simon Peter recognized Jesus alive and risen in Jerusalem. We have recognized Jesus alive and risen in Orleans. To recognize Jesus alive and risen is to have hope beyond measure. No longer do we need to fear death. Yes, this life is a holy and precious gift to be treasured and shared freely. Yes, there is still ugly evil in the world, jealous of any love. And yet, as Jesus says, "Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." John 16:33. To have a Savior who has shared every step of our human journey, including our grief, pain, and tears, and including our death, is to be infinitely blessed by God. And even more, to have a Savior who has broken the chains of death and now shares our today lives at every moment is to be set free. Jesus is indeed in our midst, perhaps most easily encountered in the sacraments. It is no wonder then that we so miss gathering to break bread together these days. Don't worry, it will be a marvelous feast when we do. Yet Jesus is found in countless other ways in our lives. A thoughtful word or gesture, a careful space and precautions against spreading disease, a gentle and loving response to those who grieve. We cannot escape the reality of evil and suffering in our world. Today, especially, we remember and pray for the people of Nova Scotia and all those affected by this pandemic around the globe. And yet, through it all, Christ is risen. This is good news that cannot be contained in any one vessel. Christ has overthrown the old order of sin and death, and glorious reconciliation, resurrection, and new life awaits with Jesus. And we have been given that good news to live and to share. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen. Please join with us for our intercessions. With fervent hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, "Hear us, Lord of glory." We begin with the time of prayer for the people of Nova Scotia. God of compassion and mercy, our hearts are filled with pain and bewilderment at this senseless act of violence that has taken the lives of so many and caused so much suffering. We pray for those who have died, remembering the victims. Heidi, Lisa, Sean, Alana, Emily, Jolene, Aaron, Jamie, Greg, Corey, Gina, Tom, Kristen, Joey, John, Elizabeth, Lillian, Don, Frank, Heather, Joy, Peter, and the perpetrator, Gabriel. May the souls of the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen.
Amen. We pray for all who mourn, for parents, siblings, spouses, children, friends, the rural communities, the church families, and the RCMP family. We pray for those who were injured, for the lives and communities shattered. And we pray for healing over time. Lord, may your presence be near to hold the pain, comfort broken hearts, and renew our hope. Hear us, Lord of glory. We pray to find fresh strength in the Easter gospel, that our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
In this time of global pandemic, that our Lord will keep us ardent in our faith and confident that the end to this suffering and isolation will come. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We pray for peace in the world, for our Canadian military, including those now working in nursing homes and hospitals to care for COVID patients, for the countries hardest hit by COVID-19, remembering also the Congo fighting at the same time Ebola, and all souls in refugee camps worldwide. We pray for the church throughout the world, for people of every faith, and those who hold no religious beliefs, that we may all grow in our compassion for the whole human family. In the Anglican World Cycle of Prayer, we remember Christian communities in Kenya, Tanzania, Nigeria, South Africa, the United States, South Sudan, Myanmar, and Jerusalem in the Middle East. In Canada, we pray for our primate, the Most Reverend Linda Nichols, and our Archbishop, the Most Reverend Anne Germond. In our own diocese, we pray for the clergy of the diocese, and we remember St. Mark's, Ottawa, Julian Campbell, priest, the parish of Pakenham, Jim McCorriston, priest, for the chaplain to the fire department, Canon John Bridges. We give thanks for the rich ministry of our retiring bishop, John Chapman, and pray for him and Catherine as they begin this new stage in their lives. We pray for assisting Bishop Michael Byrd and for Bishop-elect Shane Parker. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may grant us humility and common sense to obey the public health and laws of this land during this time, and to be subject to one another in Christian love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We pray for protection for those who work in essential services, ministering to all of us. We pray for all political, industrial, and social leaders, and for all who work in the field of medicine. We pray for farmers and all involved in food production and delivery. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We remember those who are severely tested during isolation, those who live alone, families, the elderly, the youth, and all in challenged relationships. We pray for all who have limited food and money, who have lost their jobs, who are among our most vulnerable in institutions and on the streets. We pray for those who are not taking this present crisis seriously and are putting others at risk. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory,
that he may reveal the light of his presence to the sick in body, mind, or spirit, to the weak and the dying, that they may be comforted and strengthened. We pray for the souls of all who have died and those who mourn. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
We pray for ourselves and our own parish family, that our risen Savior may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection in hope and confidence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
Amen. Gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray as our Savior taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And the doxology. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
Time for a few announcements. The clergy and pastoral care team continue to strive to check in with parishioners as to your well-being in body, mind, and spirit. Please continue to access St. Helen's website, sthelens.ca, for Eastertide reflections, food for the soul, and for worship resources, liturgies, and announcements. Thanks to Derek, Ian, Maggie, and the pastoral care team, Kim, Lynn, and Paul in our financial ministries, Glenn and Kathy and Colin for ongoing ministry, and to the leaders of our various groups as each stays in contact with their flocks. Thank you to those who have made donations on Canada Helps on our website or by mailing a check to us at the church. Later, after all this is over, we will plan how to get our church finances back on track. Usually at this point in the announcements, we ask if there are any birthdays. In our family, we have two people celebrating birthdays this week. They usually sit right there. And when I make this announcement, they look at the floor. I wish them a happy birthday. I wish all of you who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries or other special events God's richest blessings. This time of isolation, it too will pass. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight and to his glory. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Now, particularly appropriate on the Sunday when we read about our Lord on the road to Emmaus, here is Emmaus, our contemporary music group at St. Helens, singing praise to Jesus.
Stay home, stay safe, stay faithful, stay strong. As we rejoice in the risen Lord,
thanks be to God. Alleluia.